Hi, I'm Marge Easley with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to engage in conversations about important issues. Welcome to our Video Voters Guide, and welcome to Mitch Greenlick, candidate for State Representative, District 33. Hi, Mitch. Nice to have you.
Hi, Marge. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. So, you're a longtime serving state rep, and tell folks a little bit about yourself and also what boundaries are your district.
Happy to. I've been serving House District 33 for 7 terms now. I'm running for my 8th term. The district starts in Northwest Portland and goes west all the way out into Washington County. Goes about as far as 172nd and is entirely north of Highway 26.
Okay. And why have you decided to put your hat in the ring again, once more?
I have a lot of work to do yet. I think I've done a lot as chair of the House Healthcare Committee over the last 5 terms. We've decreased uninsured rate in Oregon. We've been moving the healthcare system in very important ways, and we're not quite done yet.
Okay. Can you tell us, I know healthcare is one of your top issues, what are some of the things that you would like to accomplish in the next session?
Well, there are some really serious problems facing us. The cost of drugs is maybe the number one problem we're facing. It's affecting the Oregon health plan, it's affecting private health insurance, and it's very much affecting citizens. I had a woman in my office the other day who had 2 kids with hemophilia. And their medication cost $10,000 a month, each kid. She had good health insurance, but in order to get her medication, she starts by writing a $13,000 check every year as a way of doing that. We just can't have too much of that. So I've got a task force working. We'll have a plan to begin to reduce the cost of drugs and the effect on individuals. Very high on my agenda.
And when will that task force be completed?
I hope they'll have a report within the next week or two so we can begin to get it ready for the 2017 session.
Very, very good. I know that besides the price of drugs, that also the issue of emergency preparedness is important to you. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Right. I've been working on the modernization of the public health system now for 4 sessions. We finally have a plan that's been vetted by the Public Health Division. We expect to move that forward over the next decade. It's going to take a long time to get modern public health services available to every citizen of the state, but it's important to do. For example, if we have a major earthquake off the coast, one bridge will go down on every road between the coast and the valley, and the coast is going to be isolated trying to deal with things like cholera epidemics that they're just not prepared for now. So we've been working with the state, with the county, and with individuals around the state to move this forward. I hope we'll take the next major step in the 2017 session.
Now, all of those things that you mentioned are going to take some money. And when you're talking about emergency preparedness, you're also talking about improved infrastructure. And
absolutely,
the transportation issue is a big one. So that brings us around also to Measure 97, which is a way that proponents have touted as a way to bring needed revenue to Oregon. Could you tell us your view about Measure 97?
Well, to go behind Measure 97, the problem began with Measure 5, where we took away the local funding from schools and handed it to the state, and Measure 11 made that even worse by pushing our prison system into a place where we spend more on prison than we spend on higher education. Education, social services, and public safety make up 95% of the Oregon budget, and we simply don't have enough money to do the things that we know we need to do for the citizens of this state. I think Measure 97 is a fair and equitable way of bringing back the fair share that large businesses, particularly out-of-state corporations, pay. They have not been paying their fair share, and Measure 97 helps to mitigate that and to bring that back into proper perspective. We still have the lowest business tax in the country. The Oregonian had a front page story on it over the weekend. It's time now to make that fair. If we raise another $3 billion a year with Measure 97, we have a chance to put money back into the schools to reduce class size, to increase the number of days of education, to get college tuition affordable, to do the social service things we need to do because we need to be taking care of our aging population. So it's a very, very important measure, a very fair measure, and I urge the citizens of this state to pass Measure 97.
Now, I know that tax reform has been on the agenda of many, many legislative sessions long before you came into office as well. Do you feel that Measure 97 is a long-term fix or is a short-term fix?
Well, I think we've been dealing with this probably since 1858. I'm sure the first Constitutional Convention started talking about taxes. We have a long way to go. We have a very odd tax system because it only has property tax and income tax, not the third leg, the sales tax that most other states have. We need to be, I think, working at long-term solutions, but the citizens of Oregon have not been very interested in having any changes in the tax system except reducing taxes. We've reached a point where I think we need Measure 97, even if we can't create, I think it brings some more fairness and more stability into the system. And I think that's important. So even if we can't get some overhaul of the tax system, and it's, I've been looking at it for seven sessions now, we haven't been able to move the mark at all. It's a very important step.
Okay. Another issue that's important to the League and many other folks around the state is gun violence prevention. We weren't able to pass the Charleston loophole, close the Charleston loophole last session. What are your thoughts on gun violence prevention legislation, and would you be supportive of that particular thing as well as extreme risk protection orders and the assault weapons ban?
Well, I think if we had had another couple of weeks, we'd have been able to pass the Charleston loophole. It's a very important loophole. Right now, when people come in and have a gun check, if the answer doesn't come back in 3 days, they can still sell a weapon. I think that's a very bad idea. We'll be working on it, and I think I'm a co-sponsor of that bill. I've also worked on assault weapon banning. I don't think we need assault weapons in this state or anywhere in the country for that matter, except for military purposes. We certainly don't need it for deer hunting. When you start working on that, you get into a morass. You really poke the hornet's nest, and I end up with 3,000 phone calls and thousands of emails. But it doesn't stop me. It's a very important public health issue to me. I think those measures are very, very important, and I think we're going to be working on them in this. And I'm going to be very much in the middle of working on them in this next session.
Okay. You have one opponent in the general election, a Republican. So could you tell us what you bring to the table and why folks should want to reelect you to continue another term?
Well, I think I bring an important progressive agenda with me. I think I've been experienced. When I came into the legislature, our uninsured rate was about 17%. We're now down to 5 or 6%. The official data, I've had, I think, a lot to do with that as chair of the House Healthcare Committee. I bring that special healthcare expertise and perspective and a view of what the citizens of Oregon need. I've also worked very hard for my constituents when they have problems with the state agencies. I've had the experience that I've delivered for this district in some very significant ways. I'd like another chance at it, so I'll ask whoever's watching to make sure they vote for me if they're in House District 33.
Great. And I'd like to just ask folks to remember that Election Day is November 8th and to make sure that they do vote. So thank you so much for being here today.
I'm very happy to be here. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you.